I think coming to Broadway was an absolute revelation for him. In many ways, it was the people he encountered in the countryside who had a lasting and huge influence on him. The Thatchers, the Stonewallers, carpenters, all these people who were practicing their crafts in Broadway and in Camden, where he went to school. And of course, it was his father's ownership of the Leigh and Arms which created much of the sort of interest, because they were carrying out a lot of work at the Leigh, so there would be many craftsmen and people with unique skills working there at that time. So I think they were all a great influence on him. The father was re-establishing, as it were, the previous glory of the Leigh and Arms. It had been a great coaching inn. When he left school in 1908, his father said to him, well, we must find something for you to do. And they already had a little furniture workshop with one craftsman, and Gordon was put into that workshop. And he always said that at that period of time, taking fine pieces of furniture apart, seeing how they were made, how they were constructed, the overall design, respect for material, all these things impacted on him, I think, very significantly. So just before the First War, he had actually started to design a few very simple pieces, principally beds, because beds weren't readily available on the scale that the Leigh required them.
These are some interesting items which clearly show that he wasn't only a designer of furniture, a fine skilled craftsman in all sorts of other ways, a calligrapher of the finest. He was also a designer of many other things, and one of the interesting things is that these are the buttons, silver buttons he designed for the head porter at the Leigh and Arms. When the head porter died, Gordon's father actually had them taken off his uniform and had them put on his own dress suit. These are some items which really show what Gordon Russell was. Particularly this beautifully illustrated book, The Story of a Cassin of Nicolette, completely done throughout by him before the war, and shows his ability as a calligrapher from a very, very early age.
When Gordon Russell returned from the war, and he'd survived 4 or 5 years of the horrors of that period, he came back determined to create something for future generations of value, because he felt that his generation had destroyed so much. And fired with that passion, he also felt to design and make furniture in reasonable quantities which would be affordable by a much wider market.
This is one of Gordon Russell's own drawings, dated 1924. It's to 3 inches to the foot scale, and this was all that was had. And Gordon Russell designed these cabinets purposely to house these drawings, numbered from 1 to 1,000. And what is interesting is that we have got all these drawings right up to around 900 of them. The finger grips are in bog oak, slightly contrasting to the natural oak. The other interesting detail again is the through dovetailing on the solid carcass, giving not only a very strong structure, but completely decorative on from the top and along the side. The carvings for the numbers have been carved and recessed with painted blue, and times he told us that that was called Cotswold blue, but I don't know whether that's true.
He was greatly influenced by the arts and crafts movement, and in particular by Ernest Jimson, who was, I think, one of his heroes. His work really followed and developed, perhaps, on those traditions. But it wasn't groundbreaking. I mean, he was following, in a way, a tradition that had been well established. He interpreted it with imagination.
And then we come, of course, to this famous piece, It was taken to the Paris exhibition in 1925, and there it won the gold medal for cabinet making, which we're very proud of because we've still got the certificate. This is going back to 1924. He'd only been out of the army about 4 years. It is magnificent. It's an English walnut with these beautiful ebony handles. On all these pieces, we do have the label. And as this one says, designer, Gordon Russell, foreman, Edgar Turner. Cabinet maker was William Marks, and the metal worker was S.G. Gardner. And it's interesting because a lot of the pieces also had Ligon, because a lot of the ranges were given a Ligon range. And then, of course, the inside of the cabinet, we come back to the metalwork, which again was done by S.G. Gardner, totally hand done. And what is interesting, when you look at the drawing of this, you can just see the little bits of difference that he would have put in. And that is what Gordon himself always was delighted in. And he spent a lot of time going and discussing in the smithy or in the workshops with the person making it, because there was very little detailing in its fullness. So there was this wonderful combination of the craftsman and the skill between them. And then, of course, we've got the drawers here, again, made in totally in the solid, with these beautiful oyster veneers on the front of laburnum. And this is clearly seen that the veneer is cut across the branch, showing all the annular rings, giving this absolute beautiful pattern. And then the lining, as we call these cut-in lines, in boxwood, to make the pattern with, again, the ebony handles, very delicately designed. The inlay, these are very fine again. That's ebony, and then you've got yew tree and pear wood, beautifully cut in entirely by hand, giving this wonderful feeling of depth and almost perspective look about them. And then, of course, we've got this wonderful detail here again of dovetailing called decorative dovetailing. And you can see the pins and the tails are different shaped, and then they got this beautiful radius on them, but they just show up as a beautiful pattern. The legs are again amazing, because I did once query how Gordon himself, from the drawing we've got, set out these inset pieces, when in fact it's clear that he gives this as a pattern, and it's the cabinet maker who would have worked out his dimensioning to work it down through. And each of these are a separate inset of ebony, and each one is faceted by hand before it's inserted into the recess, which again gives this absolutely magnificent pattern, and yet it's so simple.
Gordon's basic tenets or beliefs in what he did was, I think, so honesty is the word that sort of springs to mind. I think that he always felt that he had a commitment to the material he was using, the purpose to which it was going to be put. His furniture was designed to be used. Everything that he was producing in the early 20s was aimed at the ordinary man. Craftsmanship was essential.
This piece is a boot cupboard and has many striking features about it. It is 1925, but does not have the through dovetailing as a decorative piece. These are secret dovetailing, so you don't see any of the skill in that joint showing. It is basically a simple in its proportion, but it's come to a point when new materials were being brought in, and the door is made in what is called lamming board, which is an absolute stable board with lippings and the details cut in with its shut-in joint in ebony. It's one of the most simple pieces and has been often spoken of as foreshadowing the coming in of the machine.
I I think if one looks back in future years and say, well, what did he actually contribute, which was important to 20th century design? I think the major contribution was this acceptance of machinery. Machines had been regarded as being a bad influence on much of Victorian society. So he decided that he would teach the machine manners and that he could actually design and make work which would reach a much wider market and a much more affordable market. And this is the crusade that he embarked on with the support of his father, who thoroughly backed him in the enterprise and, as they described it, the great Broadway adventure.
This suite of furniture is called the Western Group, and it is striking about it is the simplicity of all of it. The simplicity of a rectangular top, but what lifts it out also is these beautiful fluted legs, and the sideboard matches in exactly the same sort of way in its simplicity. Drawer fronts, framed and panelled doors, using plywood for the panels. The chairs are as simple, but all of it can be machined to lift it into a totally different price bracket. And this, of course, is what Gordon maintained throughout. And as often we've been brought up on that expression that he used, we had to teach the machine manners. So this is a wonderful example of a machine being used for the benefit of keeping furniture to a level which was available to more people than the earlier pieces.
My personal view of the furniture produced by Gordon Russell Limited is that it represents a very English kind of compromise between tradition and modernity, which is not a criticism, because the result is very easy to live with, very humane and undoctrinaire. I think that represents Gordon's point of view, because although a lot of it wasn't designed by him, he was in a real sense the design manager before that term was really in use.
Gordon designed something like 820 pieces of metalwork, furniture, glass between 1922, when he essentially started, and until 1930, when he stopped designing. And when one looks back at that, I mean, it is quite a remarkable achievement, because as well as building up a workshop, which by 1930 was employing in excess of 100 people, it meant that he was designing something like 2 to 3 pieces every single week. We believe that many of them were actually designed probably at Kingham in the evenings, but to be producing work of that quality consistently over a period of 8 years is remarkable in itself.
The early workshops, which were up in workshop near the Leigh Arms, shows the early machines that was used within the factory. Another very important little picture of one of our finest cabinet makers in his early days again. And then this lady, which is very interesting, served throughout the war in the factory here in Broadway.
The factory needed skilled craftsmen, although it did quantity production, it needed a skilled staff. And being in a little country town, it tended to have a very loyal staff. So if you went to the factory, you had a strong sense of continuity.
I think he was inspirational. Probably his great strength was his ability to talk to people, communicate people. He motivated and created loyalty from people who worked for the company. And they all talk about the spirit and the sort of the ethos of the workshops. They all felt part of a sort of great team of people.
He never was for throwing overboard the past, but equally he was always open to new ideas and always interested in the idea of experimenting with new materials, of fitting new thinking to new circumstances.
In the 30s, the company went through a very, very difficult period. I mean, we had the Great Depression, and that inevitably impacted on the company. And here was a sort of a new wave of modernism being brought into the what we were doing, what the factory and workshops were doing. But it was a very, very difficult period. And in some ways, I think the company might well have gone under, but it was rescued by a most unlikely saviour in the form of a man called Frank Murphy. He was going to embark on the new craze for radios. And he said to Gordon, well, I'd rather like you to take on designing cabinets for these radios. Would you be interested? We started in the early 1930s to design cabinets for the Murphy Radio Company. And Gordon designed the very first one, which we have in the museum. And throughout the 30s, we were making, we employed almost 1,000 people. I mean, the business grew to an enormous size. You know, this is a big enterprise. This is mass production. And here's an arts and crafts man. The whole thing is quite extraordinary. But the overriding thing, I think, is the admiration I have for Gordon for seeing something like that as an opportunity and one which he couldn't resist.
One area where he did have a very benign influence, I think, was in the utility furniture scheme. The guiding principle of utility furniture was very much precepts from the modern movement. And I think these were well combined with this other influence from tradition to provide furniture which really, if only it hadn't been called utility furniture, was the IKEA furniture of its day. During the Second World War, Britain was desperately short of materials of every kind, short of food, short of textiles, short of timber, and what there was of these things needed to be directed towards the war effort. At the same time, people still needed to be able to have some new things, particularly the victims of war damage needed to be able to have a new wardrobe, they needed to re-equip their house. And the government's utility scheme was to try to ensure that these things were well designed, that they were not extravagant, that they were good value for money, and that they did the job.
The utility range. The whole of the period of the utility range ran from 1941 to 1951. And this is a very fine example of a piece of utility furniture in the form of a tall boy of 1943. It's always a shame, we've often thought, that it's called utility, because it is not utility, because it carries every practice of cabinet making to its very best ability, and using a machine to make very solid construction and using, because of the restrictions, the minimum of timber. So we have a lovely example here of a very usable drawer, and showing down here a true machine dovetail and very useful storage. But the construction is mortise and tenons, plywood panels, but generally carrying every aspect of fine craftsmanship.
Gordon was put in charge of what was termed the design panel. And the design panel was charged with designing a range of furniture which could be made by literally hundreds of little firms all over the country, probably employing no more than 5 or 10 people. But they had to be able to make it to a standard, and they had to make it to a standard design. And when one thinks about this, it's an immense task. I mean, the production must have been on a huge, huge scale.
Oh, yes. And what is interesting, this is the logo, which is always stamped on every piece of utility furniture. In many cases, it was a brand mark. Each firm who made utility had their own number, And this company, Gordon Russell Limited's number was 418.
The utility furniture program enabled Gordon to sell to the great British public what he'd been trying to sell them all through the 30s. Suddenly they had no choice. It was Gordon Russell or nothing.
Gordon Russell himself always told us that a chair is the most difficult thing to design. So much is attached to it. Its first use is comfort and to support. I'm sitting on the chair that was made for Coventry Cathedral. We made 2,000 of these chairs to very strict specifications given to us by the architect Basil Spence, who designed the cathedral. And there are many features about this chair which become interesting in the respect that, first of all, they had to stack. They had to be able to be bolted together and hooked together for safety reasons. They also had to have a prayer book at the back shelf and also the means of hanging the kneelers. But with it goes the requirement for a chair in those conditions to be extremely strong. And this chair has got engineering principles attached to it for its strength. The whole of the slab unit is made as one complete unit with machine finger jointing at each corner. The back is again finger jointed, giving it a very strong top. And the legs, particularly interesting, are supported and locked together by a block which is let into the side rail and into the top of the leg and is locked with machine screws which are pelleted at the corners there.
I think it's hard now to recapture the feeling about design at the time when Gordon was the director of the Council of Industrial Design. It was very much double-edged. That's to say, there was an enthusiasm for design, perhaps, and a recognition for it that had not been there before. Pioneering work before the war had seen to that, much of it by Gordon. But equally, it was not generally accepted. British industry particularly was a very hard nut to crack, and I think Gordon spent endless amounts of time trying to persuade industry that it should take design more seriously. Equally, the taste of the British public would be well described as conservative. So between these two things, there was quite a squeeze. Obviously, it is right that Gordon is celebrated and remembered for the furniture design work that he did, but I think that his work as somebody who was a champion of design in a very difficult period has perhaps been underestimated. Perhaps because we now more or less take it for granted that design is important. And that wasn't taken for granted at the time when he was doing that work. He was a brilliant ambassador because he was urbane, gentle, seldom lost his temper, always trying to find a way to get people to agree. I think it's interesting that although it was fully appreciated that design had an economic value in those years, that wasn't the main argument put forward by the Council for Industrial Design. The main argument was that it was rational, humane, aesthetically pleasing. I think he had a non-stop struggle with, for example, the committees which selected goods for the design centre to make sure that they followed these precepts.
The design centre in the Haymarket was a mecca, really, for people who went there to see what was the newest things in the way of product, furniture. People flocked there, and it had this very important educational function. So he remained throughout his life very, very committed to education.
Kinkham really was, I think, one of the great loves of his life. Of course, Gordon didn't build the garden and house at Kinkham single-handed. However, for such a large project, he did do an astounding amount of it himself. He liked nothing better than to get his boots on and get out there and heave stuff around.
I'm in the garden of Kinkham, which is a rare pleasure. It's a garden which I've seen develop and grow over 50 years. It is the work of somebody passionately interested in not only the sort of the structure of gardens, but the planting. Every aspect of the garden, I think, reflects that interest. But what is quite remarkable, this garden is built on the side of a hill, overlooking wonderful views of Chipping Camden, but it is essentially built on the side of a hill, and it's had to be carved out of the hill. And the main part of the garden is a series of terraces, which involved huge amount of earth moving, which was done without the benefit of modern day machinery. And it took him, in effect, from 1936 until he died in 1980. Gordon really was always interested in lettering. And he went on to develop this interest into carving stone. And of course, his own house bears witness to a great deal of carving, executed with great skill. Go and have a look at his coronation table, which was carved to celebrate the Queen's accession. And there are lintels which celebrate his golden wedding. He wasn't without a sense of humour. There's a little water spout, which is carved in the form of Gordon, complete with glasses. And there are little gems tucked away in the garden of the house.
Which his wife, Tony, I think was driven nearly demented by the amount of time that they took to finish.
Strangely, he also had a passion for concrete. And the house, which he built at Kinkham, virtually with his own hands, employs a lot of techniques which were carried out in concrete. He also liked the idea of using other ways in which to create pattern. Even more remarkable is a beam which concrete has been cast against wattle hurdling. And when that's taken away, you're left with this very nice pattern from the basket work. But even more extraordinary is that when I once asked him about that, he told me that he first saw that in the First World War, when he admired the quality of the construction of the German gun emplacements. Well, for a man who probably faced death the following day, I find it unbelievable. But it just shows his perception, his observation. He was a magpie. He never missed an opportunity to acquire building materials where he could find a use for them in the garden that he was building. Another example of his love of natural forms was to lay freshly cut cabbage leaves in the shuttering for the beam that was to be cast. And when the concrete was cast against it, it left a pattern of cabbage leaves. He was able to acquire a number of railway platform sections, beautiful Portland stone, and he created a whole series of descending pools, flanking a series of steps in the garden. One feature of the garden is a whole series of arches which stand above a stretch of water which he described as the canal. But within the arches are set quite literally thousands of wine bottles. The ends of the wine bottles reflect very beautifully in the water.
One of his great skills was as a stonewaller. And here he is repairing a wall that had collapsed at his property at Kinkham. And again, this picture speaks of itself to you of what this man was. And this is how he loved to live his life in the garden.
The garden is a wonderful testimony, I think, to an escape, in a way, for Gordon. This is where he came to write. It's where he came to relax. And he was never happier than really when he was covered in cement dust. And those were the best moments, I think.
The effort that he put into creating Kinkham over a very, very long period of time created a splendid amalgam of traditional and modern thinking, which perhaps is absolutely characteristic of him and his work, both as a furniture designer and as a very important and influential thinker about design and shaper of public policy on design in Britain.